I said when we started this a few days ago that one of the causes of the Great Depression is what? World War One. We're not going to explicitly state that, but you need to understand that one of the things that leads to this great economic downturn is the end of World War One. And you'll see that in just a few minutes. Yes. I'm looking at both of you. Oh, yes. Look at there.
I used the other one. I did not use the grid marker.
No.
London. Oh, so you were just... Okay. Got it. All right. On to more depressing things. So one of the causes of the Great Depression is the World War, particularly with what happens regarding Germany. And we're going to see that. We'll see it more when we actually talk about World War II because of what was going on in Germany. It has an impact on the United States, of course, and really the rest of the world. So, a couple of essential questions. How did forces of nature affect the economy of Georgia? There are two things that happened. One you know, one you might not know. What do you think? What's that one thing that you know? The boll weevil, a natural occurrence. The other, we'll talk about in just a second. And do what? No. That's a good guess. And the second one is, how did state and national political policies, in other words, what Georgia is doing politically, what is happening in regards to policy in the state of Georgia? How does that help Georgia develop and grow? And how does it impact the future of politics in the state? We've already talked about the county unit system created by the Neal Primary Act in 1917. And of course, that's going on during this time frame. But we're not going to talk about politics, at least not initially. All right, so Georgia agriculture takes a tremendous hit in the early part of the 20th century. The New South era, of course, the triumvirate, you know, the proponents of the New South, Henry Grady, are trying to get farmers to diversify. What do they mean by diversify? To plant something other than cotton. Booker T. Washington comes in, George Washington Carver, I guess, more accurately, talks about crop rotation. He's teaching at Tuskegee Institute, and he tries to get people to rotate their crops rather than grow the same thing year after year after year, because that leaches the soil of its nutrients. It destroys the soil. All you got to do is look at the Dust Bowl. It's one of the things that leads to the Dust Bowl is failure to diversify, failure to rotate crops in and out, and the soil is depleted. Farmers are starting to kind of buy into it, but before they can really diversify, the boll weevil comes. 1915 is when the boll weevil comes into Georgia. Comes out of Texas through dust clouds that are swept into Georgia. Oklahoma, that area. And of course, it is a destructive little insect. It's an ugly little thing. There's nothing good about the boll weevil. I can't even understand why the boll weevil exists, because all it does is eat cotton.
It's got a pretty cool name.
Well, it does. It does. By the time my daddy's born in 1922, Georgia's cotton crop has been reduced by two-thirds. Two-thirds of Georgia's cotton crop has been destroyed. And if you're a farmer, depending on cotton, and suddenly two-thirds of your crop is gone, what happens to your income? It decreases by two-thirds. What happens to the amount of money that you can spend at other places in Georgia? It decreases. And so not only do farmers take a hit, but the overall economy takes a hit. And we'll talk about some things that happened because of that. Map showing the progression of the boll weevil. We think it came from Argentina through Mexico, through Central America and Mexico, and then ultimately into Texas. And it spreads as far north as Virginia and, of course, as far south as Florida and South Texas. Over a period of, 30 years. And the boll weevil's really not eradicated until about 1980. So it was around for a long, long time. And that coincides with the revitalization of the cotton industry in the South in the 1980s. All right. This is in your notes, I think. Just kind of the lifespan of the boll weevil, kind of, circular. Eggs hatch in about 3 days, 3 to 5 days. They feed on what's inside the square or the cotton boll, and then they change into a pupa. Pupa. I like pupa better. A pupa. They stay in that stage for about 3 to 5 days, and then they're adults. They feed, they mate, and the female begins the process of laying eggs. So what do? They just eat cotton. That's all they do. That's their purpose in life, is to eat cotton. I do not know what else they do. I'd be interested to know.
They make babies.
They eat and make babies. What a life. And die. They do die. I think the way that they actually eradicated the boll weevil is they made it where the female could not, or the male couldn't fertilize the female eggs. Yeah, which is the idea. All right. Cute little fella, don't you think? But you can see the adult boll weevil. Here's a cotton square or a cotton boll, and you can see the larva inside of it. They actually cut that so you could see it. But can you imagine you've planted, 1,000 acres of cotton? Everything's green and pretty, and it comes time for it to bloom, and it doesn't bloom because there's nothing inside that boll to bloom, or two-thirds of it doesn't bloom. And that's what many farmers faced. Interesting monument in Enterprise, Alabama. It is a monument to the boll weevil.
It's just so weird because it's like this Roman Greek, ancient human being.
With this
beautifully crafted.
With this big boll weevil. Well, it's Alabama. Okay. And it's funny, you ride through the downtown area of Enterprise, Alabama, and right there in the middle of the street is the monument to the boll weevil. Why do the people of Enterprise put up a monument to the boll weevil? Join them. Well, actually, the boll weevil causes the people of Alabama to do something, to change, to diversify. No. They do not do that. There's still places in Alabama that do not do that. But it causes farmers to diversify. Peanuts become more of a cash crop in Alabama and ultimately in Georgia because of the boll weevil. And so the people of Enterprise, I think it's a pretty good idea. They put up a monument to the boll weevil. Let's see. Oh, come on. There we go. This is a good song.
No, Woody Guthrie.
Arlo Guthrie. It might be Woody Guthrie. I don't know. This is good stuff.
Oh, weevil, I see you at my door. Yes, I said, oh, weevil, I've been there before. Gonna get your horn, gonna get your horn. Farmer said to the grocer man, I want some meat and meal. Get out of here, you son of God, you got four weevil in your field. Gonna get your horn, gonna get your horn. Farmer said to the banker, I want to make a note. Get out of here, you son of God, you got a bull weevil on your coat. Gonna get your horn, gonna get your horn. Farmer said to the dry goods man, I want to cash a check. Get out of here, you rascal, bull weevil on your back. Gonna get your horn, gonna get your horn. Farmer said to the finance man, I'd like to get a car. Get out of here, you so-and-so. Got a bull weevil in your hair. Gonna get your horn. Gonna get your horn.
Yes. Woody Guthrie, you're right. That's good stuff. It just don't get any better than that. Well, I expect it does. All right. So, after having watched, yes.
I just have to add, someone like Guthrie, that's known for making, you know, these really good
protests.
Yeah. Motivated song.
Yeah.
Being the heroes, people like Bob Dylan and Johnny Cash, really creating the folk genre and then making that song. I mean, it's just great.
Well, but Woody Guthrie was, you know, he was the minstrel of the working man. I mean,
his guitar killed fashion.
Yeah, I mean it, and so I think it's absolutely appropriate that Woody Guthrie would write the boll weevil song. I don't know that he wrote it, and it's been recorded. Good gosh, you'd be amazed at the number of recordings you find when you Google the boll weevil song. It's incredible. Some of them are really good. The Wiggles. The Wiggles. The Wiggles. And it is terrible. It is the worst thing. We watched it first period, and I am stupider for having watched it. I just feel my brain cells died.
We all want to watch it.
No, you can't. I will not watch it. You can do it on your own, but I will not watch it. I will not expose young children to that kind of torture. Because it is bad. All right. So that's the first natural disaster that occurs in Georgia, the appearing of the boll weevil. Second thing happens in the mid part of the 1920s, and that is drought. So the boll weevil comes in, destroys two-thirds of Georgia's cotton crop, and then drought strikes. And that drought lasts from 1924 to 1927, roughly 4 years where Georgia has minimal, if any, rain. And you can look at the map here. The dark color is, what does that say? I can't even see what that says. Exceptional, I think.
Yeah, it's drop level 4.
So, you know, it's really dry. And then as you get toward the coast, as you go to the center of the state, it lessens. But look at North Georgia. I mean, very little, no rain. And in fact, this becomes the worst drought in Georgia history, even today. And we've had drought in the 21st century, the latter part of the 20th century, that's pretty severe. But this one beats them all. 1925 is known as the year you could walk across the Chattahoochee River. So if you've ever, you know, driven through Atlanta, paid a close attention to the river, it's a pretty wide, broad river when it gets to Atlanta. It was down so far that you could literally walk from one bank to the next without getting your feet wet.
Yeah.
Every year for the past 6 or 7 years, my dad and I have gone on a trip from Macon to the coast. Just like driving our bike down the river. And the first year we went, the old Mulkey, I believe, was at record low. And in Abbeville, the water level was like at -3 feet. And we came apart across parts of the river where we had to push the boat across.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
Yep, and this was worse, if you can imagine. So, what happens during a drought? What happens to crops?
They can't grow.
It can't grow.
Dust.
You get dust. That's right. And so, on top of the boll weevil, you have drought. And one thing you can say about farmers is they're people of faith. They keep doing the same thing year after year, expecting crops to grow, expecting adequate rainfall, not too much rainfall, because that's just as bad as not enough. And, you know, during this time, they're still planting, but nothing grows. Third thing is the cost of farm equipment. In the early part of the 1920s, late 19-teens, manufacturers stopped making animal-powered farm equipment. Now, why is that a problem? Not everyone can afford mechanized farm equipment. And now, on top of the boll weevil and the drought, you have producers not making animal-powered farm equipment. And so if your plow breaks, what do you do? You either have to fix it or you have to scrounge around and find one. You can't just go to the supply store and buy a new plow. And you can't afford to buy a tractor. And most people in Georgia, you know, my daddy started helping his daddy and they plowed with a mule. They didn't have a tractor. They plowed with a mule. You want to hear my second favorite mule story? Yes? No?
Sure.
Okay. One of my favorite authors is a Georgia author named Farrell Sams. Grew up in the Jonesboro area, Fayette County, and by profession was a physician. He was a doctor, family practitioner, you know, took care of the community. When his grandchildren came along, he wanted to write down some of the stories of his life so that his grandchildren would have them, so he could pass them down to his grandchildren. And that effort turned into a 3-volume novel. It was a trilogy. What were the names of those? One of them was Run with the Horseman. The other was When All the World Was Young, and I can't remember the third one. Anyway, great novels about his life growing up during the Depression. And he said that one of his chores during plowing season was to plow. And of course, they plowed with a mule. And, you know, there would be him and 3 or 4 other farm hands that would plow. And he said, if I didn't get there early enough, I was going to get this one particular mule. And this one particular mule was just mean. He would pass gas on whoever was plowing behind him. He would raise his tail and he would let loose with a pretty good quantity of gas. I mean, a mule's a big animal, right? Eats a lot of hay. And so one morning he knew he was late, so when he walked out the door, he grabbed a kitchen match, stuck it in his pocket, one of those strike anywhere. Stuck it in his pocket, got the mule harnessed up. Mule was pretty docile, you know, was agreeable. And he started plowing, and he said, I was just waiting. And sure enough, the mule raised his tail. And about the time he raised his tail, I reached in my pocket, got that match and lit it and held it up. A flame, a blue flame, about 3 feet long, shot out of that mule's rear end. And of course, if your butt was on fire, what would you do? Run, right?
That actually happens, though. Like that's,
yeah. So the mule runs. Of course, he's dragging the plow, and his daddy beats his butt for screwing up the plowing, but you know, he got his revenge on the mule. Mule never pooted on him again. That's for sure. Anyway, so we have Georgia farmers that are using old technology, and they can't afford to replace it, but they can't find old technology to replace what they have. So you got the boll weevil, you got the drought. Both those things cut farm production, and because farm production is cut, farmers' income is cut, and they just can't afford to modernize. I don't know that my granddaddy ever owned a tractor. I think he plowed with a mule all of his life. Which, I mean, it worked, but it's not as fast. You can see what would happen to crops during a drought, and I think that is from the 1920s. And then you can see the Chattahoochee River. If you look back here in the distance, you can see where the shoreline would be or where it's supposed to be. And it has fallen that much. Yeah, that's probably 7-8 feet, if not more, in places. And, of course, these people are sitting out in rocks in the middle of the river. Ask the question. Because, well, why? Because it's picnic. Hey, but why are they dressed that way? That's what everybody wanted to know first period. Because that's what people did in the 1920s. You know, even up until when I started flying in air, on an airplane, you know, that was the early 1980s. I think it's the first time I ever flew. And people actually dressed to fly. You know, you put on a coat and a tie. Women wore dresses. You dressed. And now, you know, you wear your pajamas. It's become like a bus. I'd kind of like to see a return to that. Everybody wears a coat and tie. Women wear dresses. Anyway, it's just personal preference. All right. So you see different farming implements that would be animal-powered. Plows, disc harrows, all sorts of stuff. And then you start to get into mechanized stuff. And here, an ad for a tractor. What would be more efficient, the tractor or the plow, the mule? The tractor. You don't have to feed it. You don't have to water it. It's not going to poot on you. You just have to fill it with gas and or diesel or whatever. But it's a lot faster too, right? Yep. All right. So the Great Depression impacts Georgia farmers really early. And again, World War One. Without World War One, there's no Great Depression, or at least the Great Depression is not as bad. But cotton production in World War One is out the roof. Demand for cotton is high. Production is high. What happens when the war's over? Well, people aren't wearing uniforms, right? The army reduces in size. The navy comes smaller, becomes smaller. And so there's less demand for uniforms. There's less demand for cotton cloth. And so prices fall. What happens to the farmer? Their income falls. And so couple that with the boll weevil and the drought, Georgia loses about 60,000 farms in the 1920s. 60,000. My daddy was asked by Joel one day, Didi, that's what he called him, Didi, what was it like to live in the Great Depression? That's a pretty good question because my daddy was 7 when it started. And my daddy looked at him and kind of laughed and said, son, we didn't know there was a depression going on because we didn't have anything anyway. And that was the plight of most people in Georgia. The depression hit hard. It hit early. Really, the early 1920s. We're not going to wait till 1929. Georgia was already in the throes of a Great Depression. Number 4, the migration of farmers. farmers quit. Farmers give up. We can't make a living farming anymore. We're moving to the city. We're going to get a job in a factory. We're going to go sell shoes. We're going to go be a policeman. We're going to go be a fireman. We're going to do something in the city because we can't make a living farming. The boll weevil, the drought, cost of farm equipment. Farmers just can't survive. And so in the late 1920s, about the time the Great Depression is really hitting the rest of the country, a lot of Georgia farmers are leaving the farm to go to the city. And in many cases, it just makes their plight worse. Because as the Depression hits, are there jobs in the city? No. And so they've left the farm, and now they can't find work. This is Atlanta, by the way. Little Five Points, I think. It's a cool building. Graph, I think this one's in your notes. You can see early part of the 1900s, most of Georgia's people live where? On the farm. The blue is the rural. And then as we come out of World War I, still a pretty good majority, but more and more people living in the cities. Great Depression hits, 1929. We see more and more people live the farm. And then down at the bottom, 1900, 85% of Georgia's population lived in rural areas. In 1990, it was 25%. In 2004, it had dropped to 2%. And it's probably less today. I mean, that was 17 years ago. Roughly on 50,000 farms. That'd be family farms. That'd be corporate farms. Most farms in Georgia are tied to some corporation somewhere like Green Giant or Del Monte or one of the other big food companies. So fewer and fewer people are farming. There's an article that I'll get you to read at some point in time this week about rural Georgia and how it's viewed by the rest of the state, primarily Atlanta. It's a pretty good read. We're not going to do anything with it. I just want you to read it so you have an idea. All right. You want to stop right here? You want to keep going? We'll stop. Huh? Yeah. What were y'all doing? Sleeping during that time? Huh? What was it? That must be it. Migration of farmers. Oh, yeah. Well, if you really got to hear it,